When Jean Wade approached me about taking part in faith gathering, I thought I would like to read something from the Hebrew scriptures, but the Psalms came immediately to mind. We're living in troubled times. Our hearts are restless. We struggle to find unity. And the Psalms often provide us with a sense of well-being. I thought about that word unity, and I thought first of the beginning of Psalm 133, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to live together in unity. A beautiful sentiment. But that psalm, that short psalm, goes on with some rather obscure metaphorical language, which brings us a little comfort, and so I turned instead to one of my favorite psalms, Psalm 46. It turns out that the 46th psalm was also Martin Luther's favorite psalm. It is from that poem that he wrote his, or he was inspired to write his great hymn, Ein fester Burg, a mighty fortress is our God. This is a psalm which has been a source of comfort and strength to people of faith for 3,000 years. It brought a sense of purpose and peace to the Jews during their exile in Babylon, in Jerusalem, overrun, conquered, and Solomon's temple lying in ruins. It was a source of strength as well to early Christians in the first and second centuries as they were persecuted by the Romans. Huguenot Christians, Calvinists, in the 16th and 17th centuries found strength and comfort in these words, and they wrote about their comfort and their feeling of strength as they were severely persecuted by the French Catholic majority. Who can doubt the comfort and assurance European Jews must have found in these words during the terrible days of the Holocaust? I believe you and I today can find equal strength, comfort, and assurance as we face troubled times and blind hatred, in knowing that the source of our strength is the Lord of hosts, the source of all our strength. So I'd like to read a portion of Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth be moved and though the mountains be toppled into the depths of the sea. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble at its tumult, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come now and look upon the works of the Lord, what awesome things he has done upon the earth. It is he who makes wars to cease in all the world. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear, and burns the shield with fire. Be still then and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Father John Shetler here for Father Pat. We appreciate your prayers, so I'm sort of pitch hitting for him today. I was asked to gun violence is something that's very raging around us, and I don't know what the answer is. I continue to pray for God's wisdom for all of us, and the courage to know God's wisdom, and the courage to do what he asks of us, no matter what your faith is. When my niece was 16, she witnessed on her block, a man was shot. Instead of running away, she ran towards there, and she was my hero. And the man died in her arms. At 16 years old. I woke up this morning to the news of Thousand Oaks, and my nieces and my nephew and my sister and brother-in-law have all departed in that country western place we come by a natural, okay, for the Cowboys. I posted on my Facebook page, and I have about 1,600 contacts. And a lot of people praying for us right here, right now, at this time. A friend of mine who now lives in Pittsburgh, I was delighted, and I said I would share with you. They took a collection up with all the Catholic churches in Pittsburgh, where the community there had three of them. They helped them with their costs for funerals and wherever the need is. What I'm going to do is pray for you the prayer that is very near and dear to my heart, the prayer of St. Francis. If you close your eyes and meditate and reflect that if there's going to be peace, it has to begin with us. And typically, wherever I go, whether I'm ordering a hamburger or I'm at a restaurant or I call on an issue for on my credit card and I get somebody from India, I will say, sir, is there anything else we can do for you? I said, yes, world peace. So when it starts, it's going to start at Starbucks, and it's going to start here at Sagewood, and it's going to start on Facebook, and it's going to start wherever we have it. If we bring it to the front of our mind, and maybe we'll actually make it happen. And so we pray. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there, I think God's saying amen to that. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned. Done, that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
On behalf of Gene Wade and Warner, David, John, Rabbi Mark, Rabbi Cantor, thank you all for being here this afternoon. Today, we are all members of Tree of Life. As I was preparing for today, I came across an article of a great mentor friend of mine, Richard Parrish, and his article on the dark night of the soul began to resonate with me. My goal today is really to help us understand this truth, that when we find ourselves in the valley of shadows, we must follow the shepherd who lights our way. Speaking of shadows, you may have heard the expression, a dark night of the soul. The expression comes from a Spanish monk, St. John of the Cross. For in his poem, he choreographs words of how the darkest times of our soul are not to move us away from God, but towards God. King David must have understood that when he wrote, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley in the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." In contrast to conventional thinking, David wrote this when he was much older in his life. He was reflecting back on his life, and as he was doing that, thoughts of taking care of his dad's sheep must have come to him. And in the springtime, the sheep would be down in the lower plains because the grass was already there, ready and good for the sheep. But as summer came, the heat would burn up that lower area. So they would have to take the sheep to the higher elevations. And on the way to those higher elevations, there would be crevices and cracks and valleys and dips up the mountainside. And inside those valleys and dips, it got dark. Really dark. And if you know anything about sheep, number one, they're dumb. They're really dumb. And number two, they get fearful very easily. Kind of like us. And David knew that. And while he was taking the sheep up, he would understand that he would have to intervene at times to get the sheep moving and away from their fear, because the valley became deep and dark. It's at this time I want to reflect on just a couple things from this psalm, for I find great comfort in this. And again, the one truth is that I want us to think about over and over again. It's times like this when we are going through those darkest of valleys, we begin to ask the question, how do we move forward? How do we move forward when we're facing our own dark night of the soul? David writes, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." The English translators took a little liberty there. A better translation would be, "Even though I walk through the darkest of valleys," or the valley of shadows, to better understand. And I kind of take to that because I've worked in hospice for 16 years. And there's one thing that patients have told me over and over again. "Paul, I'm not afraid of death. That's not the issue. It's the dying process that I'm afraid of." And I think that is one of the dark valleys that we walk through as human beings. Among others, the loss of a child, a divorce, a loss of a relationship. Those are all dark valleys. But David brings us back and he says, here are some things that we can cling to as we walk through the dark valley. Number one, we don't need to fear anything, for the Lord is with us. We have his constant presence with us. Even when it's the darkest of night, when the density of the valley is so deep, God is right there with us. That brings us hope. Incredible hope, my friend. David writes, "Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." And if you know anything about shepherds, they carry the rod to ward off enemies like a bear or a wolf or even a mountain lion. David bragged of that when he, right before he fought King Saul or Goliath, how he killed a bear. He probably used a club, the rod. He also used a staff to rescue sheep when they were in places that they found themselves in. That brings us security. That brings us comfort. And that comfort is knowing that God will defend and protect his children at all times and at all costs. But I know what you're thinking. Paul, 11 people lost their lives on that Saturday. How did God protect them? Well, I think David has an answer for us. Because in verse 6 he says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me. Literally, it means chase after. God's got two great sheepdogs, goodness and mercy. And they are constantly chasing us. And he says, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. David's not concerned about death so much in this psalm as he is about the shepherd. And that our focus turns to the shepherd, to Adonai, when we come to dark valleys like this. And speaking of dark valleys, the Lord wants us to know that even in those darkest of valleys, there is a purpose. And that purpose is exactly what I mentioned earlier. When we find ourselves in the darkest of night, the darkest night of our soul, the darkest valley that we can think of, even the tragedy at Pittsburgh, we must trust the shepherd who will light our way. That light, according to King David, is found in believing and trusting in that shepherd. That's what King David believed and directs us to do, to believe and trust in the shepherd. That's what God's word says, to believe and trust in that great shepherd. So what say you? May the peace of Adonai be upon you, upon Israel, and upon all those who love Israel. As David wrote in another song, Shalom, Shalom, Yerushalayim. Amen?
My responsibility is to recite a memorial prayer in Hebrew and English. I do it in Hebrew. I'm going to recite not only the English, but the Hebrew names of the people of Pittsburgh who died. And then I think I will also recite a few of what's been said, the memorial prayer called the Kaddish, which doesn't mention death, but which expresses, at least for the Jewish community, this idea that the future will be, we can get through what we have lost and have experienced and on the future, and then we pray for the time when we've gone beyond the kind of pain that we experience. And but first, we're here in part, I guess, because it was a synagogue, the Jews were in prayer. But there were kids having a good time last night. They're dead also from someone who had rage. Sometimes we don't know why. In the case of Pittsburgh, we were told why this person was enraged. I don't know if you know what enraged the gentleman who shot up that dance hall. But whatever it was, those parents, those families, those friends were also in pain. And so as I recite these prayers, at least I am thinking of them as well. There's a chant to this memorial prayer, and then I think it's going to be. I don't know what's going on this case. I'm going to use this. I'll be fine. Elo aslichot chanun barachu Erech apayim barach chesed Hamatei kaparat pesha Vahakrabat yesha Menuchan chanan tachat nefe hashmina Emalat kedoshim udarim Kedohar harakiya Masvimet nishmo Joyce Feinberg Yiddish Utcha bat
Abba Menachem, Richard Gottfried, Joseph Nathaniel, Rachel Bat Abraham, Rose Cavender, Yehuda Danyaseskel, Jared Rabinowitz, Chaim Ben Eliezer, Cecil Rosenbaum, David Ben Eliezer, David Rosenbaum. Bernice Simon, Bela Rachel Bat Moshe, Zalman Chachna Ben Menachem Mendel, Sylvan Simon, Daniel Stein, Daniel Avram Ben Baruch, Moshe Gadol Ben Yosef Melvin Wax, Yitzhak Chaim Ben Menachem Irving Young. Shehalchu Leon Lama, Ana Balaras Amin, Zohra Lahem Letova, Kol Zichiyotehem, 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 Yar Torah Chaim, Uftach Lahem, Sharei Tzedek Beora, Sharei Chemla Vachanina, Veseter Kenafecha, Hasirem, Le'olamim, Letzor Bitra Chaim Et Nishmatam, Adonai Kunachalatam, Ve'yaduchu B'shalom Amishkevotam, Ve'nomar, Amen. Out of forgiveness, you who are gracious and compassionate, patient and abundantly kind, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and pure to the souls of Joyce Feinberg, 75, Richard Gottfried, 65, Rose Ballinger, 97, Jerry Rabinowitz, 66, Cecil Rosenthal, 59, Brother David Rosenthal, 54, Bernice Simon, 84, her husband Sylvan Simon, 86, Daniel Stein, 71, Melvin Wax, 88, Irving Younger, 69. Merciful One, we ask that you remember all the worthy and righteous deeds that they performed in the land of the living. May the ones that we remember find perfect peace in your eternal grace. May their souls be bound up in the bond of life. May they rest in peace and again let us sin. Yitkadal, Yitkadash, Shemei Rabbah. Yalmati Barach Yerutei, Yam Lechmach Yerutei, Hachayichon, Yomichon, Ruchayei Lechol Beit Yisrael, Bagala, Yizman, Chayu, Yemir, Amen. Yehei Shemei Rabbah Barach, Yerlam, Yomei Amen. Yitbarach, Yishkabach, Yitpa'ar, Yitromam, Yitnasei, Yitadar, Yitalev, Yitalam, Shubay de Kusha, Yusha. Leilamin Po, Yerchata, Vishirata. Tushpatata, Venetamata. Aviran the Allah, Yimu, Lema. The Hei Shlama Rabba, Min Shaya. The Chayim Alenu, the Alpon Israel, Yimu, Yimu. Ose Shalom, Yimu, Ma. Hu Yase Shalom, Alenu, the Alpon Israel, Yimu, Amen. We pray that the God of the universe, of all life, who was able to create an orderly world that we're still trying to understand, help us create the kind of peace and understanding where we live. There's a melody for those who know it. So thank you. Help me with that. Ose shalom b'mrama, hu yase shalom aleinu, ve'al kol Yisrael, v'yiru, imru, amen. Yase shalom, yase shalom, and make peace. Shalom aleinu, y'al kol yoshvei tevel. Yase shalom, shalom aleinu, y'al kol Yisrael. Yeru, amen.
We thank all of you this afternoon for attending. Let's continue to demonstrate our caring for each other. We have a Sagewood history here of caring. Let's continue to show it. Now let's go in peace with love for all our neighbors.
Thank you. Need you to call me, honey.
Okay.
So thank you, but I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
It.
I called
what
you.
What happened yesterday?
Did you get my voicemail? I came
yeah,
over.
I got earlier. It.
Oh, gotcha.
But I saw you here, and I wanted to tell you. Thank you for responding.
Yeah.
What happened was Chris came and put in Viacom in, and he cut off my
and that's
printer.
It's happening a lot. I know. It just kind of.
But what? No. He explained my printer doesn't have a screen. So he couldn't look at the screen,
to add it.
But he needed, what do you call it, what kind of a cable?
USB printer?
Yeah, but he didn't have one. And to tell you the truth,
yeah?
That all the guys who are working here should have one with them.
Yeah, they should. It